pocket to buy some juice. You gotta bring your own bags and you learn to reduce your waste. We gotta learn to reduce. And if your brother or your sister's got some cool clothes, you could try them on before you buy some more of those. Reuse. We gotta learn to reuse. And if the first two R's don't work out, and if you gotta make some trash, well don't throw it out. Recycle. We gotta learn to recycle. We gotta learn to reduce, reuse, recycle. Reduce, reuse, recycle. Reduce, reuse, recycle. Reduce, reuse, recycle.
Building Green is supported by BARTA.
Oh, missed the introduction. Used to hearing the song and it didn't happen. So good morning, welcome to Building Green. My name is Bill Vitale, I'm the host. The program airs live in this slot each month, the fourth Tuesday at 10 o'clock. My guest today is County Commissioner Kevin S. Barnhardt. Kevin, in addition to being county commissioner, is the vice chairman of the BARTA board. And you've been on the board
About 6 to 7 years okay. When Reading pulled out as a local sponsor during Act 47. Mm-hmm. And the county became the sole local provider of the match money with PennDOT. And I thought there should be someone from the county being accountable to the county as well as to BARTA. And I've enjoyed it. It's been a real learning experience. People think running mass transit is mundane, but it's not. It's pretty exciting. You learn a lot at each meeting that we have. So I'm really thrilled about being on the BARTA board as well as the South Central Transit Authority.
Yeah, and we'll talk a little bit about what the difference between those two are. And BARTA, in case anyone out there doesn't know, is the Berks Area Regional Transit Transportation Authority. Basically operates our public bus system in Berks County. So the topic today is BARTA and the South Central Transit Authority, and we're going to talk a little bit about that and about those systems or that system and public transit in general, and briefly we'll touch on how it relates to Building Green. So I should mention that BARTA is the sponsor of this program, and thank you BARTA for sponsoring the program. It's
most welcome.
Helpful to keep this on the air. Is that light on? Yes. So before we get into talking about BARTA and transit, maybe you want to just give a little bit of background on yourself. And
sure.
And I know before you were county commissioner, you were the city council person or council person in West Reading, Borough of West Reading,
well,
and the mayor?
Right. Started out at the ripe old age of 23 as a council person in West Reading. Served 15 years on borough council, thoroughly enjoyed it, and then thought maybe I'd branch out into something different, so I ran for mayor and was mayor close to 9 years.
Okay.
So that's kind of my political area. I moved then from West Reading to South Heidelberg Township with my wife and kind of got bit by the bug to stay in politics, so I decided to run for county commissioner in 2007, was elected in 2007, seated in 2008, so I'm in my 10th year as a county commissioner. Love every minute of it. It's challenging at times, but it's really, really it's a give back for me to the community.
Right.
I really like to see at the local level, whether it's at a borough, township, or a county level, you can see the benefits of your decision-making process. Harrisburg or Washington, I think it gets diluted, here in your own hometown, you can really see what takes place.
Yeah.
On the business side, I was basically in the food wholesaling business most of my life.
Okay.
I had been with Associated Wholesalers, Wetterau Foods, and Redner's for a period of time. I had left Associated Wholesalers to run for county commissioner, wholesaler in Robinsonia, Pennsylvania, so I'm kind of a fruit and vegetable guy most of my life. So enjoyed both ends of it, but really enjoy being a county commissioner and serving the community on various boards and commissions, and especially the BARTA board. It's it's really enjoyable. It's become more enjoyable when BARTA merged with Red Rose in Lancaster County. We formed a management company of South Central Transit Authority, kind of the parent management firm overseeing BARTA and Red Rose. And we've interacted with the folks from Lancaster. We're like a family now. We're in year three of our marriage, and it's just amazing how easy it came together. And I think that's a tribute to Dave Kilmer, our executive director. Unfortunately, Dennis LaWers, our executive director at BARTA, passed away, and Dave had worked for BARTA, so we hired him on as a management consultant for about a year. And the folks in Lancaster were getting itchy to make a decision. We said, hey, why don't we just join forces? Mm-hmm. PennDOT incentivized us to do that. PennDOT has incentivized us with saving the local match, and I brought that up earlier under Act 47, where Berks County was paying close to $500,000 and Lancaster about $400,000 as a match. Providing we save that money in operating costs, which we did, then PennDOT said, you don't have to make that local match to contribute for 5 years. So we're in year three of that, not having to contribute $500,000 towards the Mass Transit Agency. We're happy because most of the money does, for most of the vehicles, comes federal, and for the routing is generally state funded. Certainly, we can't charge the amount it would cost somebody to get on the bus. It would be cost prohibitive. So the rates are about $1.70. It's free for those over 65. That's through the lottery system. So we move about 2.8 million people a year on our fixed route. We have 19 routes throughout the county, and many of them are very, very full many times of the day. We were speaking before the meeting. Our Fifth Street route is the number one route. We've added more frequent pickups and deliveries on that route because it's just full with 50% of the people that generally get on our buses are workers, and generally the other half are basically shoppers who don't have access to a vehicle, mm-hmm. Elderly folks who want to go out shopping. So mm-hmm. it's a great service, and we're proud to have it. We make tweaks along the line. We may curtail a route, may add to a route, and we're always looking through our providers of funding through the state and federal government to see where else we should be branching out into the community. So we will go where there's a justification for enough people to get on a bus. That brings me to the point. We did talk about a potential route from Reading to Lancaster, Lancaster back to Reading. It's something that would be studied to determine whether there's enough passengers per hour traveled. It's expensive to run a bus, right, with the driver, with the fuel, with the equipment. So we want to make sure it's viable and feasible before we start that. But it's something that could happen in the future.
And if there was going to be that run, how would it be, one run a day?
It would probably be frequently in the morning, maybe several times in the morning, uh-huh. several times midday, uh-huh. and then several times in the afternoon. Mm-hmm. We did experiment a number of years ago with a Lebanon run, trying to encourage people who go to the Lebanon VA, mm-hmm. Go up there for service. We tried that for 3 months. It was unsuccessful. We couldn't encourage people. And what we did find out while we were doing that is the Red Cross, and there's veterans groups that actually transport a lot of people. So there was sort of a service there already that I'm sure if people like to be picked up by a van from the Red Cross and taken to the VA, they were happy. But it all boils down to greener energy and the ability to move more people than one person driving a vehicle.
Right.
So the more frequent pickups that we can have buses full with 20, 25, 30 people, or our shared service, which provides for people to pick up for doctor's appointments and medical procedures. That's a shared ride concept, which really helps to take cars off the roadways. So caregivers, family members don't have to provide that service. So half a dozen people get on a shared ride vehicle and go to their appointments.
Is there a term for that service?
Shared ride.
That's shared ride.
We paratransit shared ride.
Right. And my mother-in-law, who passed away this past summer, she used it a number of times for visits. And I think it just cost her a couple of bucks. I've heard.
Right. It's again, that's part of a subsidized function. There is a minimum charge for it. You have to live within a certain distance of BARTA fixed routes.
Uh-huh. Right.
But it works out. I guess your provider of the service that has to be a little bit flexible with your schedule, because we try to be pretty accurate with getting people picked up and delivered to their place and pick them back up. Mm-hmm. So run a tremendous dialysis system. I have a friend whose father is on dialysis over in Wyomissing, and I've picked him up on occasion at night, and there's three or four specialized transportation vehicles there waiting for the folks who are finished with their procedure. It's just a service that truly believe that the government collectively has to do for people, because they don't have the means or the ability to do that themselves.
So it's that service in particular, as are the others, is a win-win. It's a win for the environment, as you said, because you've got less cars making that trip. Mm-hmm. It's a win for the family, for the person who needs the medical care, mm-hmm. for their family or caregiver.
Sure.
Just facilitates everything. And I can say that in terms of my mother-in-law. I mean, it just eased the burden on everybody when she had an appointment. Mm-hmm. Someone didn't, you know, to the extent possible, we would be there to help her out.
But certainly we gained benefits from less fuel for the shared ride. Even more so the fixed route. Of our nearly 50 vehicle mm-hmm. fleet, about 16 or 18 of those are hybrid buses.
Yeah, so
converting from fuel to electric as they pick up RPMs saves a tremendous amount on fuel. That, in coupled with the lower fuel prices last year, now keep in mind with more and more hybrid buses are a little more expensive than your conventional
sure.
bus,
mm-hmm.
but we feel that's the right thing to do. And with the lower fuel cost, we saved $1 million in our operating budget. Of $18.5 million operating budget, that's significant.
And that
to
is
save that kind
that's
of money.
Fuel.
That's fuel.
Yeah.
That's fuel. And we burn a lot of fuel. Uh-huh. And uh-huh. the less uh-huh. we can burn, the more. What happens when you save that kind of money and fuel cost, you can provide us more frequent pickups and deliveries. You can mm-hmm. you can use that. I mean, the yeah. state and federal government doesn't take it back. Mm-hmm. It's within your mm-hmm. budget. And you say, look, we're able to add a route to a certain location, or instead of picking people up every 25 minutes, we can run a bus every 15 minutes.
Mm-hmm.
We don't want to leave people sitting behind. That's why we study the frequency of pickups, because if the bus is full and you can't get on, you're going to be late for work.
Right.
And
right.
you don't say, well, are you going shopping? Are you going to work? So you draw straws on who gets on the bus. Very mindful of that. So we really think that's the trend, and that's the way we want the future to go.
Now, when we were talking before the program, you mentioned the frequency of pickup mm-hmm. in the context of the merger. Is there any relationship between the two that facilitate going in that direction?
In the way we saved money with the management structure, we were able to add the frequency mm-hmm. of routes because we got to keep that additional funding for local services.
Mm-hmm.
So Red Rose in Lancaster mm-hmm. County, they opened up a warehousing facility down near Gap. So they actually created a route to go down the Gap to haul workers back and forth from center city Lancaster
uh-huh.
down the Gap.
Uh-huh.
And we picked up more frequency of runs because we saved that money.
Mm-hmm.
So we could reinvest it into helping people to ride.
Yeah, unlike maybe a private bus company or a for-profit company, you mm-hmm. have the... Where are you going to put the money? You're going to put it into providing
right.
better service.
And you think $1.70 for a trip, if you actually sat down and calculated how much it cost you to run your car,
yeah,
that $1.70 is probably you sitting at a traffic light burning fuel.
Yeah, well,
when you can get on a bus and only spend $1.70. We have discounted rates for 30 days for, you know, senior citizens. There's different, you can get a 10 ride pass, you can get a 30-day pass. And it's really, really trying to get people into the buses more frequently. We saw an uptick in use of buses when the economy, when fuel went to close to $5 a gallon back in 2008. We saw a spike in people riding buses. We saw a lessening of people riding buses as the economy got a little shaky and the unemployment rate went to like 9%. Now those things have kind of leveled back out. Unemployment rate of around 5%. People are back working. And a lot of these folks rely on that. I mean, if you're working at a shopping center, a mall, and you're earning less than $12 an hour, you probably can't afford a vehicle and the insurance and all the
mm-hmm.
stuff that goes with it. So we're happy to mm-hmm. Move these people back and forth. We also have a special service I want to note. Those folks who do ride fixed route, they also can be provided. We heard loud and clear that people, they may work till 11 o'clock at night. They might be a maintenance person at a facility, and now the bus has stopped running. If you got there by bus at 5 o'clock in the afternoon, we have a service that will pick you up and take you home. It'll be basically a paratransit vehicle will pick you up. So that anyone who's interested can contact BARTA, let us know your situation. There's a kind of a financial requirement. I think most folks that I'm speaking of probably would meet that financial requirement, and it's part of the service. So we're here to help people
right.
shop, go to their doctor's appointments, their medical procedures, as well as the folks working. It's great. We move, say, close to 3 million people. People may be shocked to hear that number, but we're out there 7 days a week. We're out there Monday through Saturday on all 19 routes. We have 8 routes on Sunday. The 8 routes on Sunday are the most frequently used routes. We certainly...
They are.
Yes, mm-hmm. yes. And actually, one of the things, not even this is something you don't think about, is the workers and the shoppers, but the churchgoers. So we had requests from people that say, look, I want to get to church, but I don't have a car. So we established those routes, and we heard loud and clear from the folks who wanted to get to church.
And they're successful with people.
Yeah, very much so. They that route, that Sunday route system just exploded on us. We were using Sundays just in December for the holidays, and we figured let's give it a go and let's get that out there, because...
And there used to be Sunday service that was suspended. Now it's been...
Yes, it was suspended about 20 years ago.
Yeah, a long time ago.
We recreated it. I don't think anyone remembered that.
But, yeah, right.
We recreated it because then again, not just the shopping, but the people that work at the shopping areas, they work Sunday. They have those odd hours. They're probably off Tuesday and Wednesday, and we're running a bus Tuesday and Wednesday, but we're not running one Sunday. How do they get to work?
Yeah.
They have to rely on a taxi, which is expensive. They have to rely on a family member. So why not provide that service for these folks and help, and certainly help the environment, as get those people on the bus.
Get them on the bus. That's
exactly
that's
right.
That's why we're a big fan of public transit. Mm-hmm. So the Access to Jobs program, that runs how late?
It will run till about 1 or 2 o'clock in the morning. Right.
And Minna, I'm going to ask you to, I don't have the number, but, and then for a senior, just let me ask you about the senior riding. Number one, does BARTA get reimbursed funds of any kind for that program?
For the medical, there's medical assisted transportation that we get reimbursed by the state, as well as the refund that we received. We have to justify through audits that we received the transfer of money from the lottery system.
And then the seniors ride, anybody over 65 rides for free. Does BARTA get some kind of compensation from the state?
Yes, we get reimbursed through the state for that as well.
As well, so you keep track of that. So it's so it's a benefit to BARTA and the community, if not only to the senior riding, but everybody makes out.
Right.
So if somebody wants to contact BARTA, before we forget to do that, just Google BARTA.
BARTA,
know the phone number offhand? Or what's the best way for somebody to get information?
Contact the office. If it's transportation for paratransit specialized service, call and ask for Vicki Widener. Okay. She's our paratransit specialized service director. She does a phenomenal job. Or stop in at the office out at BARTA, and they'll be happy to help you. Transportation center down in Franklin Street. We move all of our buses through there. Mm-hmm. That's not really the place you go to sign up for everything. You can get a 10-day pass or a 30-day pass there, but really getting set up, either drop in or call BARTA.
Yeah, I neglected. I planned to have BARTA's phone number. You don't happen to have that?
I wish I did.
We'll get that. Maybe we'll get the BCTV folks to get that number.
Made that huge mistake not bringing the phone number.
Usually the logo is on there at the beginning. I don't know. Can we get that number up at some point?
Make a very good point, because a lot of the riders we have they can't afford a vehicle, so they may not have access to a computer either.
Yeah, exactly.
So
exactly.
The good old phone the stop
phone call. Yeah, but otherwise, if you do have access to a computer, you just Google BART and it'll come up. Mm-hmm. Which I want to clarify, there is the South Central Transit Authority, which is an administrative merger.
Correct.
The BART bus system and the Red Rose in Lancaster still operate as they did before.
They didn't change one iota.
Right.
That was part of what we looked at, and we said, look, we're not going to upset the apple cart. People know Red Rose. They know their drivers. They know the logos. They know, and the same thing with BARTA. BARTA's been around for 40-plus years since the Reading Bus Company went out and BARTA picked up. We wanted the sameness in both regions, and it's worked out tremendously well. The South Central is the part you don't see. It's like the parent company of two subsidiaries running Lancaster and Reading.
Providing some administrative efficiencies.
One executive director, one HR director, one accountant, so IT support. That's really where we found the synergies. We were using a lot of the same technology anyway, because a lot of the technology is sponsored through the state and federal government. So we found such a transparency that it worked out tremendously well.
And I guess a sharing of expertise and experience and learning back and forth. Okay, one of the things that I did want to just touch on briefly was you mentioned the downtown, the transportation center.
Yes.
And I was on the Reading Planning Commission for, I guess, about 10 years, and it's going back about 10 or 15 or 20 years. But over the course of that, a number of projects actually came through. One was the, you know, let's go backwards, let me go back a step. BARTA, over the years, has been, in a sense, one of the major developers of downtown Reading. Through
stream
funds,
right.
The Penn Square,
right.
Renovations of Penn Square, mm-hmm. As I recall, and you said something about you wouldn't think it would be fun, but it's kind of enjoyable being on the board, mm-hmm. And I'm sure part of that was Dennis Lewis, because Dennis was
energetic, when he was the premier facilitator of federal money. He was looked at by all the other transit agencies in Pennsylvania as the guru. If you wanted to learn how to fill out a grant request and get money squeezed out of the federal government, it was Dennis Lewis, God rest his soul. He was the one that was able to, and he helped everyone.
Yeah.
He was that gregarious. He would help everyone because he truly believed in his heart and soul about mass transportation.
Yeah, no, he did. And I realized, I dealt with him in a couple of different ways. One, when I was on the Planning Commission, it came before us for particularly the Penn Square project, and I think the Transportation Center, I might have still been, I'm not sure. And then I actually, BARTA was a client a couple of times related to the Franklin Street Station, so I dealt with Dennis.
He had a vision there too, right?
Huh?
He had a vision there too.
Incredible vision, and his ability to bring those funds to the community, we're really
sure.
Was really
you know, we stage and repair and maintain the buses out here on 11th Street, but really you need to move the facility that's hauling in and out to where the people are.
Yeah, yeah.
Where's that downtown Reading? Yeah. All the routes start and end there. All but three don't go. All but three routes go out of Reading, come back. It's like 16 of them are mostly in the general Reading area.
Mm-hmm.
And his dream, and I think it's eventually going to happen, but it's going to take a lot of cooperation with neighboring counties, is to reestablish rail service to Philadelphia.
Well, right.
That was
right.
His dream with the Franklin Street Station, which was Reading Railroad, Conrail was turned over to the city of Reading, was in, as you well know, deplorable condition. The ceiling had collapsed into the floor.
Oh, yeah.
He secured that $5.2 million through the federal government and said, look, I have this belief, this vision, this is going to happen. Believe it's the only last physical structure of the Reading Company Railroad, Reading Railroad, so that was part of the inducement to restore that building. Mm-hmm. Even if there was never a train going to Philadelphia, it still needed to be restored. Mm-hmm. And we honor him for that. Magnificent job was done there.
My hope is that people will get a chance to see it. I understand there's going to be some kind of
The Broadway show Sweat is going to be putting on a multimedia demonstration there.
Yeah.
It's
a one-shot deal. It's going to go on.
It's about 2 months.
Yeah, 2 months.
It's going to take them several weeks to get it set up, and then it's going to go for a month. But they want the community to come in and share their experiences.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know, we look at this play as somewhat negative, but I think it can get us somewhere else.
Yeah.
I think it can start putting us in the right direction. So we're utilizing that. We're allowing them to use that for, basically we're asking for the expenses. We turn the air conditioner on, turn the lights on, pay the utility bill, which is great for BART. It shows that we're part of the community and want to celebrate that building, really want to do. And hopefully with enough people in this community and justifying running that route, that bus, but running buses from there, because as we expand service, as the county population grows in the next 20, 30 years, the BARTA Transportation Center is going to be maxed out as far as trips.
Right.
So additional routes that would run to, say, Lancaster would probably come out of the Franklin Street Station.
So,
a route to Philadelphia would come out of the Franklin Street Station. Dennis's dream was to have everyone leaving on mass transit coming out of that area, including the
inner-city bus terminal.
His drive was to get Bieber and Trailways and everyone up to the same area.
Yeah.
So you want to go to New York, Philly, you want to go to Wilmersdorf, you're all going out of the same place. So visionary. Absolutely a visionary.
Yeah, I think so. And I think both with that project, all three of them, but there were some things about that project, the Franklin Street Station. You restore a beautiful old building like that. There's definitely a green component, and it was It was done to the extent possible as a green project. Mm-hmm. We didn't go for LEED certification, but there were any number of aspects, including the mechanical system and the restoration work. remarkable reuse of existing materials. I mean, the floor, the terracotta, I mean, things that, that building, right. in spite of the roof being in such bad shape, is a testament to the way things were built and the way that was built, that that building survived. And
1931, I think.
1930, I think, yeah. And hopefully. And then went into disuse in 1981 when rail service was right. suspended. So, I encourage people, check out the paper. I'm sure there's going to be a lot of publicity about this this event related to SWET. It'll be an opportunity to go in there and see both an interesting event and to see the building.
Right.
The Penn Square project, and you may not even know this because maybe you weren't even born yet.
I remember the circle. I stopped at the 6th floor toy department at Pomeroy's. Yes, I'm that old, so I remember.
But, Penn Square was, they had closed the block between 5th and 6th, which, on paper, in theory, it seemed like a great idea to create.
Didn't know
until
you tried, right?
It just, it didn't go anywhere. But one of the arguments and one of the aspects that BARTA, Dennis and BARTA were able to get the funds was what was happening because Penn Square was closed. Buses were going to Washington and Franklin Street, and I forget what amount of fuel was being saved by the buses being able to go straight up Penn Street. And that was part of the justification for the funding. BARTA secured all the funding, and really it was an urban revitalization project funded by BARTA, not only creating bus berths, but the paving, everything. So
I'm sure Dennis had that all figured out. I'm sure he had it all calculated, because even to the point about hybrid buses saves 25-30% on fuel, just that hybrid switchover. It's amazing what it can do, and we have to look for more of that type of green technology, smart technology. It's really about the future and saving our planet. I mean, we have the non-believers, the people that don't believe scientists, but I truly, my own heart and soul, believe that we are damaging our environment. We have to be with these emissions. This just isn't something that was designed into our Mother Earth and can sustain this type of damage. So we have to start turning that back around. More fuel efficiency, cleaner energy. It's going to have to come. Even though you have untold amounts of fossil fuels and things, that's not the right direction to go into.
Thanks, Kevin. I think it's a good segue for me to kind of wrap up the program. We have a minute left. Commissioner Barnhardt has just really put this whole conversation in context, and there's some alarming things being proposed and acted on at the federal level right now, and I want to encourage anyone. First of all, we share, any really serious thinking person who sets aside politics, global warming, climate change is real. It's created by CO2 emissions. We're emitting the CO2, carbon dioxide, and what is happening is there is a broad assault at the federal level on environmental laws and regulations, and I want to encourage people to call their congresspeople, write letters, do whatever you can to say this has got to stop. We need to keep what's been put in place by the last administration. Otherwise, we're going to pay, but our kids and grandkids are going to pay even more. So I want to thank Kevin Barnhardt. Appreciate for being my guest.
And, you're most welcome, Bill.
Contact BARTA to avail yourself of those services, and I'll see you next month. Thank you.
Supported by BARTA.